In the study that he dedicated to Stonehenge in 1663, the British natural philosopher Walter Charlton highlighted the contradictory character of this enigmatic monument. Although every monument was supposed to fight against the forces of oblivion, Stoneheads belong to those subject to forgetfulness even while they remain. I quote Charlton, "Neither the writings of men living in the same age or not long after their erection, nor uncorrupted tradition has concurred to give them life. They usually stand rather as dead objects of popular wonder and occasions of fables than as certain records of antiquity." So, attesting to a past of which it said though nothing at all, Stonehenge was becoming the sign of a huge contradiction proportional to its extraordinary character. In the words of Charlton again, "Wonderful as well in respect of the strangeness of its form as of the vastness of the stones of which it is composed, yet such has been its fate that it has outlived in itself and buried as well the names as bones of those worthies to whose memory it was consecrated." End of quote. So let me show you some images of Stonehenge represented in the 16th and the 17th century. And then Altamira, the first drawing of Altamira by its founder, the Sautuola, who was an amateur geologist, paleontologist, who discovered the cave. So unlike the Paleolithic caves, which revealed their images all of the sudden at the end of the 19th century, after having sealed them for several millennia, the megalithic monuments dwelt in the long human memory, even though the truth of their origin remained secret. In a way, and to echo Marshall McLuhan, megalithic monuments were mnemotechnic mediums without a message. The coherence of Stonehenge's form implied a meaning, but the latter remained undecodable. Its gigantic proportions suggested a collective subject whose name was though silenced, much like the bones and the names of the dead hidden under its stones. So tumuli and dolmens were represented in the Landschaft Malerei of Romantics, such as Caspar David Friedrich, Carl Gustav Carus, or Johann Christian Dahl. So it was a very important motif in Romantic painting, as sources of mystery, carrying in addition the aura of popular fables and legends. They were so ancient that they toppled over in the reign of nature, barely different from the boulders, and yet signifying, thanks to their grouping, their alignment, or their elevation, a strong decision taken by a specific subject in a memorial past. For all these reasons, megaliths turned out to be more appropriate ruins than the antique temples of the south or the cathedrals of the north, as they have never been linked with certainty to any system of faith. Those fragments of the past remained as open as future itself. Moreover, they testified to the reality of a people, of a folk, who once took hold of a territory and who resisted all the way through to the universalism of the classic. When the artists of the 20th century became interested in these remnants of prehistory, their approach still depended, at least partially, on the Romantic paradigm. Their own formalism, dissociated from any specific subject or historia, was supposed to reproduce the enigmatic effect produced by megaliths because of the erosive effect of time. But the themes of genius loci, or a creative people at the origin of these monuments and inventing through time surviving legends and tales, were also very important. One big difference distinguished them nevertheless, the modern and the romantic use of the Neolithic. In the meantime, this remote past, called the Neolithic, since the book of prehistoric times published by John Lubbock in 1865, in reference to its use of polished stone, started to carry many new meanings, of which the most important was that of revolution. Mother of all the revolutions in the history of the species, the Neolithic interrupted the slow and inextricable time of the Paleolithic. One of the most important French prehistorians in the 19th century, Gabriel de Mortillet, underlined the radical difference one could observe between the geologic layers of the Paleolithic and those of the Neolithic. He evoked a revolution that was, I quote, simultaneously physical, industrial, natural, and social. The assumption of revolution was unfolded on several levels. There was rupture between the industry of chipped stone and that of polished stone. Rupture between the naturalistic forms of the Paleolithic and the radical simplification, even the abstraction, of the Neolithic. Rupture between the visions of a monist and a dualist world. Rupture, finally, between the nomadic and the sedentary model, and thus between the economy of hunting and that of the domestication of vegetal and animal nature. All these changes had in common to cut with immediate nature. And the more the Neolithic revolution was asserted, the more the Paleolithic was sinking back into nature. The Neolithic assertion thickened the enigma of the megaliths, extending it up to the very faction of history. Strangely, while the invention of the Neolithic was pushing megaliths back into a deep past, it was also bringing it closer to history as such. One had to understand from now on the specific ways that history has realized its first big mutation and the modes of its complex transition from savagery to a social construction which was organized enough to recall the modern condition itself. In sum, the Neolithic was the first novelty in human history. It was the matricial event that was still providing its driving force to human action. For more than one, history was moving indeed in the good direction, although the Neolithic embodied a fairly old age, apt to evoke a buried and collective memory, it did not imply less rupture and progress. Several artists and theoreticians in the 30s would appreciate this synthetic potential capable to merge three contradictory modalities of modern time: deep past, rupture, progress. In the first forms of the Paleolithic, if the first forms of the Paleolithic were unbelievably slow and inseparable from the natural fabric, if the first voluntary gestures of man were irrevocably lost within the geological formless, Neolithic artifacts, on the contrary, stood out. Their polished and abstract form, as well as their constructive disposal within space, implied a clear distance from nature. As many modernists try to assert the superiority of abstraction compared to figurative representation, they were able to reduce the Paleolithic to the status of the original scene of art and to see in the Neolithic its redemption. So many praised the Neolithic because it put an end to the state of nature and its parasitic economy, favoring individualism and anarchy. They thought that despite their imperfections, these first social formations made of collectivities the subject of history. The Paleolithic was instead a purely negative, privative state. It was, I quote, without dominance and dominated, without past nor future, without religion, without cult, and without priests. On the contrary, the commentaries on the Neolithic were punctuated by notions with a collective connotation, such as the symbiosis, the cooperation, the collectivist economy. So one idealized the Neolithic, not only because it was inaugurating the collective formations and the dialectics of history, but also because it was considered as a kind of middle ground, equivalent, according to Levi-Strauss, to some of the societies he was studying. I should also mention the impact of economy on religion, which, of course, by taking the place of utilitarian magic, was making its first entry into human history with Neolithic. And this growing spiritualization, as well as the technological distance implied by polished forms, was expressed through a new artistic vocabulary and grammar. In his book Icon and Ideal, Herbert Reed insisted on the bond accomplished by Neolithic art in the terms of plastic consciousness, unification, and classification of sensual experience. Whereas cave painting was the automatic product of the perception and the vitality of one individual, the Neolithic abstraction implied the inventive and comparative process of composition and the unity of multiplicity. So this is really a leitmotif in all the Marxist art historical production. But if the Neolithic revolution had a universal significance for the species, many were those who attributed its eruption to the north of Europe. In other words, the division of the Paleo and the Neo was not only temporal, but also spatial, and hence national and racial. The sudden eruption of an art implied revolution, but it could also mean vegetal growth. The thesis of the indigenous character of the Neolithic was the common assertion of the physiologist Max Verworn, of Herbert Kuhn, or of Adama von Scheltema. So one consequence of this thesis was the ambivalent relation of the Neolithic to nature. The Neolithic implied, in the same time, distance from nature and deep rootedness. From now on, nature was taking the path of the division of soil, the particularization of the races. Universalism and particularism, human species and Germanic, English, or Scandinavian races, rupture and continuity coexisted within the imaginary of megaliths. This providential usefulness of the Neolithic was very important for many people, artists, theoreticians in the 30s. In the fascist ideological context of these years, the big issue was the synthesis of universalist industrial technology and particular cultures and races, progress and conservation. A very quick example with this painting of Paul Nash, the British high modernist, who painted in 1935 his equivalents for megaliths, inspired by his encounter with the megaliths at Avebury in 1933. I quote Nash, and here are some photographs of the same Nash. The great stones were then in their wild state. Some were half covered by the grass. Others stood in cornfields or were entangled and overgrown in the copses. And some were buried under the turf. But they were wonderful, a disquieting, and as I saw them then, I shall always remember them. Very soon afterwards, the big work of reinstating the circles and avenues began, so that to a great extent, the primal magic of the stone's appearance was lost. So, in one of the most heroic publications of British modernism, Nash also evoked the imprisoned spirit of English painting. It was, this imprisoned spirit for him was the spirit of the land and the genius Loki. The stones of Avebury incarnated the genesis of this genius, and his own painting should give life back to this lost, imprisoned spirit. So the interest of megaliths consisted in their formal agreement with novel modern forms. Equivalence for megaliths has nothing of the natural entanglement that astounded Nash when he discovered the site. It's rather quite the opposite. In an agrarian landscape molded by human work into a geometrical pattern, we can see two juxtaposed cylinders, the one standing, the other inclined. Between them, there is the gradually diminishing geometrical form of a solid. Just behind, a large board is laying diagonally on which a grid pattern is drawn, echoing the furrows of the earth. The board is pointing to a range of hills painted in increasingly artificial colors. The main law of this landscape is sharp contrast. Contrasts of forms, contrasts of effect. The immediate magic felt by Nash in front of the entanglement of nature and sculpture at Avebury clashes with its modern equivalent of decision, mastery, spirit. For Nash, this contrast and its mysterious meaning was also the modern version, the second prehistory of the imprisoned spirit of the land and its people. However, the Neolithic did not solely nourish organic and communitarian narratives. I will just mention here two temporally distant and formally dissimilar and yet conceptually strictly analogous examples of a subversive use of the Neolithic. Picasso, around 1927-1930, and Robert Morris, in the early 70s. So here, the Neolithic, it is mingled with other systems of representation, and we can see this mingling, this mixture, in a lot of drawings and paintings, which he started in Cannes, in the city of the south of France, in 1927, and he carried on in Dinard, which is a site in Brittany, in Bretagne, where there are a lot of megaliths, and in Paris from 28 to 30. The compositions of Picasso are very different from those of the British formalism. Their two main characteristics at first sight are the monstrous female or hermaphroditic figures and their progressively increasing minerality. His drawings of Dinard became frankly prehistoric, presenting precarious assemblages of forms, evoking in the same time stones and bones. The paintings confirmed this tendency towards minerality. Some were showing monolithic stones, the monolithic assemblage is sufficiently anatomized to accomplish a human gesture, such as a kiss, and others represented the other way around, fossilized buffers, hollow as skeletons, and thick as stones. But this outrageous mixture had nothing of a natural confusion. Reigns, genders, semantic regime were overlapping, but this overlapping was assimilated, contained, and unified in a quite neoclassic way. The result was new forms made neither for living nor for dying. This new ontological regime was linked to an experience of mourning, that of his friend, the poet Guillaume Apollinaire, for whom Picasso was supposed to create a monument 10 years after his death. Interestingly, so his first monstrous bodies, drawn in Cannes, were thought as monuments. These forms were in the same time organic and reified. Resulting of a new distribution of organs, magnified or suppressed according to their erotic intensity, these bodies conveyed simultaneously an unknown natural order and the world of ordinary objects, such as a chair or an easel. Their prehistoricity was mineral, paleontological, but also artistic. They evoked megaliths, while their corporal aberrations were also analogous to those of Paleolithic venues. In the same time, as Michel Leris noted in his journal, the polished aspect of his assemblage recalled a certain academic finishing touch. In another text, Leris affirmed that Picasso painted pigs of this period, I quote, ignore us and breathe impassively in a without a doubt closed world, but only because of our weakness. So Picasso's excessive anthropomorphization of stones made them comic and unviable. He settled them in a closed, autonomous, uprooted, and anti-natural world, very different from that of the British. We have two different uses of the Neolithic, corresponding to two different conceptions of art. Despite his apology of abstraction, there was an ultimately organic and naturalist conception of art in Nash, whereas the position of Picasso was more functionalist. Just as like chairs and easels served to specific tasks in everyday life, the impossible figures of Picasso, after having absorbed various prostheses, claimed another kind of functionality, neither measurable nor immediately extensive of any member of one member of another. They were supposed to act as psychical and cognitive instruments destined to help living, love, and death. So Picasso was submitting the Neolithic to, which was of course the archetype of the monument, to impure mixtures. Antediluvian, slightly neoclassic, and modern were sections of deep time. Nevertheless, these temporalities did not refer to an insular phantasmatic community, but to the complex and impure work of memory, where temporalities can coexist in an arbitrary and contingent way. What was common to all men and those legitimated the modern work on monument was the need of everybody separately to think life and death. The small dimensions of his paintings, the small dimensions of his paintings of megaliths express clearly this productive tension between the individual and the collective. Painting remained the expression of private passions, but the scale of Picasso, created by the close and tight framing of his megaliths, implied that these passions were precisely what was the most shared by men. Some decades later, Robert Morris would publish in Art Forum in 1975 the logbook of the journey he made in Nazca 2 years earlier under the title Aligned with Nazca. Aligned with Nazca was conceived as a transposition of one notation system to another, of one cultural apparatus to another, but also as an actualization of Nazca through the mediums of the present. It evoked, literally, the adaptation of the body of Morris to the lines engraved by unknowable people 3,000 years ago on the desert, and metaphorically, the lesson and alternative affiliation which was offered by these lines to his own disconcerting practice. So when Morris perceived the first bits of lines in the desert, after having wandered by car, he started to walk within them, since they were slightly digged. Once perceived, the line, alone or in its crossings with other lines, was becoming the sole and always partial datum of visibility. It was not an object, but a transmutic form in accordance with light and the movement of the walker's body. One needed to constantly adjust his vision in order to perceive it. Whereas the line hardly read when Morris looked down or near his body, it became readable at a median or far distance when he looked out, away, across. And yet, the visual experience and the kinesthetic one did not remain separated, dissociated until the end. When his gaze started to follow the horizontal surface, the latter started to disappear until it was transformed into elevation. So this indeterminacy of horizontality and verticality was, of course, completely alien to the contrasting vision of Paul Nash. Nazca and Morris shared the same willingness to form an object, to divide the horizontal and the vertical, to inscribe their forms within already fixed mediums. They both operated by the means of a total adherence of the body to the tactile body of a limitless space. In the absence of any low knowledge about the collective rights that had produced these lines, Morris analyzed his own subjective experience. It was this, as he said, solipsistic, even autistic experience that he claimed for his own work and that of other post-minimalist artists. The eye, ceasing to be the foundation of the logos, was becoming the space and the medium of the experience of a discontinuous, changing, albeit always immanent, relation with the world. So Morris made of these monuments, whose meaning was erased by the violence of colonialism, the intimate and discrete bodily and intellectual experience that he did not forget to oppose to the effloresces of public art in the States during the 50s and the 60s. The authoritarian verticality of the latter, as Bataille has done it, of course, in the documents in the end of the 20s, so this authoritarian verticality, dictating thoughts and affects, was opposed to the indecisions of the lines of Nazca, which, I quote, do not impress by indicating superhuman efforts or staggering feats of engineering, rather, it is the maker's care and economy and insight into the nature of a particular landscape that impresses. So Picasso's and Morris' use of the Neolithic diverted the dominant narrative of progress, derailed the linear trajectory of revolution, and assumed the unknowable part of prehistory and history. After the Second World War, and especially the use of the atomic bomb by the US, started a different critical reading of the Neolithic, closely linked to the formation of a planetary consciousness and the awareness of a jump in the history of technology. The idea of a second prehistory started to haunt the thought and the art of this period, from Georges Bataille to Lucio Fontana and Asger Jorn, from Pier Paolo Pasolini and the historian Lewis Mumford to the British artists and architects of the independent group. The feeling which was widely shared was that the atomic bomb signified the beginning of a new age. Not only humanity was leaving the Bronze Age to enter the atomic age, but it was also putting an end to the Neolithic and its capital inventions of writing, sedentarization, and centralized forms of power. The writer William Lawrence, who was a witness of the first nuclear test at Los Alamos, wrote in the Times, I quote him, "The scientists clapped their hands as they leaped from the ground, earthbound man symbolizing a new birth in freedom, the birth of a new force that for the first time gives man means to free himself from the gravitational pull of the earth that holds him down. The dance of the primitive man lasted but a few seconds, during which an evolutionary period of about 10,000 years have been telescoped. Primitive man was metamorphosed into modern man." End of quotation. So, from now on, an even more radical hiatus was separating the Neolithic from the atomic than the one that was separating the Paleolithic from the Neolithic. It was not a simple interruption between geological levels that was in stake, but a radical separation of man from Earth. The end of Neolithic would find other such optimistic messengers in the person, for instance, of Marshall McLuhan, but it would also find more skeptical thinkers from Galen and Leroy-Gourin to Mumford and Levi-Strauss. Today, the idea of the Neolithic reappears under the rightly criticized name of the Anthropocene, as it has been told, and I would like to finish my talk by reminding an extract of a paper which was published by Wallace, the doubler of Darwin, which was quoted later by Lubbock in his prehistoric times. So Wallace wrote, "Man has not only escaped natural selection himself, but he's actually able to take away some of that power from nature which before his appearance she universally exercised. We can anticipate the time when the earth will produce only cultivated plants and domestic animals, when man's selection shall have supplemented natural selection, and when the ocean will be the only domain in which that power can be exerted, which for countless cycles of ages ruled supreme over the earth." Thank you.